talk about mechanical ventilation during anesthesia and intensive care. My clinical experience as an anesthetist, I began as that, but we talk about the late 1960s, so most of you were not born. But after that, I have maintained the contact with the colleagues and have focused my major interest in research on lung function during anesthesia and in intensive care. So with this, I have maintained the contact with this field. You see my university building in Uppsala. This is 70 kilometers north of Stockholm. I live in Stockholm, but work in Uppsala, commuting, and I enjoy doing that. I'm also very happy to have been invited to here to a medical educational center in Italy. I understand that Pisa, Bologna, Padova are centers that are of great importance. And I know, of course, that you have the Leaning Tower in Pisa, where from perhaps Galileo was born here, may have dropped some balls, maybe a fake as well. But what I would like to show is that, since I put it right, we have leaning buildings in Stockholm as well. This is the Aula Medica at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm. So I had just a week or less than a week ago a lunch up in the top of this building, just to show you that leaning buildings do exist outside Pisa, but I understand that the Pisa Tower is something unique, special, so I will not by any other means say something. Then I thought, what do we have in common in medicine, Pisa and Sweden, Pisa and Uppsala? And then I realized that you have Giuseppe Alselli and the Swede Olof Rudbeck, who both were studying the lymphatic system. So we have things in common, although it goes a number of hundred years back. So if I want to have an introduction to mechanical ventilation, I'd have to move to another person who was active in Padova, Vesalius, that's a big name. As far as I have learned, he was ventilating frogs by manual compression of the chest. And that is, to me, the first report in the literature of somebody doing something that could be mechanical or artificial ventilation. But we have to wait for another almost 500 years before it was something that was transferred to humans. In 1903, Sauerbruch, a derma doctor, created a negative pressure chamber. And inside that, a surgeon could be and do anesthesia and surgery. So that was the background for it. It was not a perfect thing, and it developed further. I would like to show you what is happening. Thunberg, who was a Swedish doctor, he developed what he calls the barospirator, or barospirator. It's in the scientific view quite interesting, because inside this space or room that you see somebody in, it's like Henrik Enghoff, those who are interested in that space calculations may recall his name, Enghoff. He was where a patient could be, or was, together with a surgeon, and then instead of having a constant negative pressure, he varied the pressure in the space. An increase in pressure resulted in a flow of gas into the lung. A decrease in the pressure caused an expiration. And this is by simple gas compression and gas decompression with a 40-50 centimeter of airway pressure. Interestingly, the chest would not move. So this is just convection of gas by this compression and decompression. It was not, for the surgeon it was a problem, because the air drums were flapping. When the pressure increased and decreased, he got a headache by this air drum flapping. So it was not a very popular thing, but it was one step further towards what we have today. And the next step is to keep the patient outside a negative or pressure chamber. Here you have a child. This is from 1929 when Drinker demonstrated for the first time the iron lung. You may know the name iron lung. So this is a volunteer, not a patient in itself. But that resulted in a pressure variation just around the chest and the abdomen that caused an inspiration. And now it was a flow to an expanding chest and then expiration by the compression of the chamber pressure, forcing air out of the lungs. This was the ventilation until the mid-1950s, I will show you. Another example of this is a little more modern, but still an old machine, iron lung, which was the machine used for ventilatory support, for example, in polio patients. It was not widespread, but it was here and there. Then came a situation that changed a lot of mechanical ventilation. And that occurred in a neighbor country to us, Denmark. They had a polio epidemic 1952. Suddenly, they got 3,000 patients in a small country. Some half of them had a ventilatory support need. They needed ventilation to survive. And this, how do you manage when you suddenly get 40, 50 patients daily to a small country like Denmark? Do you have the equipment? No. And the problem was that 87% died in this beginning of the polio epidemic in Copenhagen. So this is dramatic. Now we talk about SARS-1, SARS-2. We may have a mortality of 1-2%. It's widespread, I don't discuss that. But here we have something that was extremely difficult to manage for any kind of hospital or in this. So how to solve this problem? This is interesting, and I hope medical students will listen in particular, because what they did in Copenhagen, 1952, that was to call in all medical students. And then they had to ventilate manually these sick patients. 4-hour shifts, day and night, week after week, as long as was needed. Now, this was a dramatic thing. And you can see how they used the machine to do this. They had a bag to ventilate the patient through an endotracheal tube. They had a soda lime canister to take away carbon dioxide, and they had a supply of oxygen air through this tubing. So this was the device that they had 100 or several hundred of, and now they had the machine, the young student. And you see an example here. This is not a fake. This is a patient who is being ventilated manually with this means. I don't know how long in this case, days, weeks. And now mortality was reduced from around 85 to 20-25%. This is dramatic. But still, you have to understand that this generation of medical students, they all had to experience the disaster of having patients dying when they were ventilating. They still have every fourth or fifth patient died. Still, this wasn't a dramatic improvement compared to 85%. So this is a little of the era of doing something to have equipment available if we get a new pandemic or a new epidemic. This was not a pandemic, it was epidemic. And it came to Sweden 1 year later. And now it was prepared by the experience Denmark had, and that was to manufacture ventilators in the larger number. This is the Engström ventilator. There are many others. I will not go into the details of that. What I would say is that this big machine, now smaller things, was the one I used for my dissertational work in the 60s and the 70s. This meant that we had the capacity to take care of the patients in a much larger extent than was the problem in Denmark, that they solved in this dramatic way. Now, what does happen when you ventilate a patient? Now we come to how does it work? And I would like to show you a simple image. If you look at the patient breathing spontaneously, you will see that the abdomen is moving more than the chest, 40 to 60 or 35 to 65%, almost double here. How do you see that? It's because the diaphragm during spontaneous breathing is the major muscle to inspire. You have also the rib cage, but this is the major muscle. Now, when you ventilate the patient, now it's a mechanical ventilation here, you will see that it is now the rib cage, the chest, that is moving the most, and about 70-75%, and just half down here, 25-30%. And you see that rather clearly if you know what to look at. And why is this difference? Well, in spontaneous breathing, it is the respiratory muscle that is most important. In mechanical ventilation, it's easier to expand the chest than to move the diaphragm, because you have abdominal tissue, stomach, liver, and so on in the abdomen. So it's easier to displace the chest wall than the abdomen. That is why it looks like the difference you see here. But this is not the only thing. If you look at this figure to the left, you see spontaneous breathing, and the major movement is in the dorsal, dependent part. During mechanical ventilation, the major movement is in the upper part. This is because of the gravitational difference during mechanical ventilation between upper and lower part. So it's easier to displace the diaphragm and the lung in the upper part. The problem is that you can develop something that seems to be a density in the bottom, and I will come back to that. But you see thus a clear difference in the distribution of the air, but also the movement of the chest and the abdomen when you compare spontaneous breathing and mechanical ventilation. How important is that? Now I go to anesthesia, begin with that. And the reason is that anesthesia is conducted or made in about 250 million patients a year in the world. 250 million anesthesias a year. And most of them are with mechanical ventilation as well. So there is a good reason to look at what does happen during anesthesia when they are anesthetized and mechanically ventilated. And we do know from experience since long ago, that you need or mostly provide a little more oxygen during the anesthesia than when the patient is awake. In air, we have 21% oxygen. During anesthesia, we mostly provide 30 to 40% oxygen, sometimes more. And why is that? If you look at the upper panel, it is a patient. I have catheterized a patient. That is why you see a Swan-Ganz catheter causing radiating beams on the CT scan in the heart. This is when the patient is awake. We have positioned the cut with the CT scanner on the top of the diaphragm. That is why you see this white grayish area. You see a few vessels lower down. Now the patient is anesthetized and mechanically ventilated. And you can then see that we now, about 15 minutes later, but it goes faster, we have done many of these, 5-10 minutes later you see this. This is a diaphragm that has been moved cranially because we have lost tone in the muscles, including the diaphragm. So the abdominal content, again, stomach, intestine, and so on, push the diaphragm in the cranial direction. That is why we see more of the diaphragm that. And this also causes a decrease in FRC, the lung volume. If you have, let's say, sitting up in FRC, lung volume around 3.5-4 liters, then when you are supine, dorsal recumbency, your FRC is reduced by 0.7, 0.8 liters. That is normal. Now, when you're anesthetized, even before paralysis, because anesthesia per se reduces muscle tone, and the FRC will be reduced by another 0.4, 0.5 liters. What does this mean? Well, it means that during anesthesia, your lung volume at end expiration is close to residual volume, similar to what you have when you do a maximum effort expiration. So we are being ventilated close to residual volume. This is a big difference, an important consequence. Let us see. You see then in the bottom, during the anesthesia, you have densities, irregular ones, that we see in all 9 of 10 patients during anesthesia, but with different sizes. This is a fair average. It can be huge. This is another patient. This comprises 30-40% of the area, and if this is pure tissue, it will come close to half the lung. So what is this? Our next step, having seen this in the mid-80s, was to go to animal experiments to see if you can look at the dense lung and see what is this. So we did a number of various animals, and this is a sheep, and if you are a little concerned, it's a sheep in the front and two doctors in the backside. And now we did anesthesia, we did CT scans, and you can see this is what we got. Very small, tiny densities in the bottom of both lungs. It is not a human patient, as you can see. There were many stomachs. There was a smell of, in the air by when we did this. Now we wanted more so that we could do histology more carefully. So we moved to another species. This is a horse, a pony. We had to measure the circumference and the diameter of the belly to know that we can move it into the CT scanner. Another problem that we faced was that, are we allowed to do this? At this time, this is still mid-80s, the ethical permits were not equally clear as they are required to be today. So we did this, but I was called to the hospital director after a couple of days, who had got information that there were peculiar patients in the middle of the night with long noses. We put a hat on the head to try to cover it. What you can see then, this is 1:30 in the night, 1986, and you can see that most of this lung has these densities. So they, so first of all, the hospital director approved it and said, don't do too many, and then we stopped the whole thing because we had done what we wanted. Another thing is, what does this mean? Those who are veterinarians know that the horse in dorsal recumbency suffers from severe hypoxemia if breathing air. They can die in the dorsal recumbency. And another problem is that we can then give oxygen, of course, but when they wake up and move and unstable on their legs, it's impossible to give oxygen to them. And some of the horses die in the postoperative period because of severe hypoxemia. And obviously this is the reason, because this is atelectasis, you see here, just dense tissue, non-aerated, not much of blood either, but there's a big difference, a very sharp border. So what we show is atelectasis. And since the qualitative finding here in horses is the same on the CT, as in humans, we dare to translate the human findings to be atelectasis. So now we have this, an airless part of the lung in 9 of 10 patients, varying from on an average, with an average of, 10-15%, and varying from 0 in few till 40-50% in other patients. Now the question is, why does atelectasis occur? People, not the least in Italy, Luciano Gattinoni, whom some may know, strong intensivist scientist, he did this in human patients, we come back to that, with ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. And the likely explanation in his case, and we also thought in anesthesia, was that this was increased weight of the lung that caused the compression. But is this true? And we did something that was intended to illustrate or show how important are the airways. We have atelectasis in the far end, alveoli that are collapsed. but they are normally ventilated via airways. And the possibility was provided when we could make studies in Grenoble using the synchrotron radiation facility that is here. It accelerates electrons up to near light speed. We are about 95-99% of the speed of light. And that means that the electrons has a very high energy level. This is still smaller than what you have in Geneva, for example, because we talk about electrons. In Geneva, they use they try to accelerate and study larger molecules. So that's requiring even more energy basis. But this is large enough. And what you can see is then that you accelerate the electrons in this circle, and then you can deviate it through a focusing center, through an animal, and then you have a measurement space. I have been there trying to understand what we are doing, what I am doing, participating in. And this is what you see then. We had rabbits. Perhaps the airs were not up that way, but anyway, a rabbit, and then you have the source coming, the electrons are coming with near light speed. And that enables a very, very strong magnification. When we did this study a couple of years ago, we had a magnification of 40, down to 40, 44 micron. Today, in live animals, live tissue, we are down to 1 micron, 1 micron resolution. It gives us new opportunities to study in tissue what is happening. And if you then look at what we got, this is from one of the rabbits, ventilated with a positive end-expiratory pressure of 12, 6, and 3. That means 3 different lung volumes, largest, middle, and the smallest as a consequence of the lower PEEP. You can see that with this PEEP, we have intact airways down to the alveoli that are down here. But at PEEP 6, we begin to see that airways are cut off. Airway closer. And with PEEP 3, even larger airways, we are still down at generation 17, 18, 19, or 21 generations. They are now closed. And still, this is the important thing, still alveoli are open or intact. So if I say that we have shown atelectasis with our previous slides, how does it come that we see this? It takes time to develop atelectasis. And that depends on the amount of oxygen. So for the intensivist, I would say that oxygen in high concentration is a poison. Of course, you provide oxygen to keep a reasonable oxygenation, oxygen tension in the blood. But there is no reason to exceed that level. It will give you other problems. And if you look at the way that atelectasis is produced during anesthesia, we have a number of steps. First of all, the fall in FRC, that is caused by the anesthetic and any muscle relaxant, but already with the anesthetic. This causes airway closure, as I showed in the previous slide. If we then have a high inspired oxygen concentration, now that is the standard during anesthesia, when you pre-oxygenate the patient during induction, then you give 100% oxygen to feel safe. I don't know whether the patient will feel safe, but you as a doctor do. And this high inspired oxygen concentration will cause a gas absorption from the alveoli. So when the airway has closed and the alveoli are filled with oxygen, it takes 4 or 5 minutes or less before the alveolus has collapsed. Then we have atelectasis. But if we have less oxygen in the alveoli, it will take longer before atelectasis occurs. But so when both are present, we have atelectasis. Now, can that also be an acute lung injury? Yes, most likely. And this is rather novel observation, so I would say that if you in the intensive care world understands and realize that airway closure may be a very important aspect on dysfunction of the lung in intensive care. It is not only collapse of alveoli. So if we look then at the distribution, we can then make another description of the lung during anesthesia, but with the link to intensive care. In the upper part of the lung, you have open airways and larger alveoli. In the middle of the lung, you have cyclic airway closure. Airways are closing during expiration and opening during inspiration. This causes also perhaps a harm to the airway wall, this intermittent or cyclic opening and closing. And in the bottom, we have continuous airway closure that causes atelectasis. And this model explains 3/4 of an oxygenation impairment during anesthesia. The rest, 25%, can be cardiac function and other aspects that I will not describe here. So what I would like to emphasize is that this cyclic airway closure may be a major cause of inflammation, perhaps more than overdistension and atelectasis. And this has a clear bearing on what are you aiming at when you ventilate a very sick patient. Do you want to prevent atelectasis? Do you want to prevent overdistension, or shall you also focus on cyclic airway closure? Then, if you look at the small step back again, if you look at the perfusion distribution, ventilation distribution, these are human patients that we studied 20 years ago or something like that, or more. You can see that in the waking situation, normal distribution of ventilation and blood flow, they are gravitationally oriented. In the upper part, you have almost no or little perfusion, depending on general blood pressure. But then down the lung, you have an increase in blood flow. In the bottom, you have the largest portion. This is a standard finding. And ventilation also increases down the lung. So all over, we have a fair match between ventilation and blood flow with a VQ ratio that is around one. But of course, you can have more ventilation here than perfusion. And here you may have a little more perfusion than ventilation, but not dramatically. Now, if you look at the patient that we studied, this is during the I catheterized the patient when awake. We moved the patient to the CT scanner and did the CT scan and then anesthetized the patient. Did a new CT scan, and you see it here. And this patient has atelectasis in the bottom of both lungs, as we regularly see. Now we move the patient during anesthesia to another place where we have a gamma camera and did a measurement that I can see here. You can see that in the there's a rather dramatic difference regarding the ventilation distribution. During anesthesia, we have more of the ventilation up here, and then it decreases down the lung. And in the bottom of the lung, there is no ventilation at all, corresponding to the atelectasis. This causes a shunt because we have perfusion still. This was a shunt that impedes oxygenation. Reading above this shunt reading, we have low ventilation perfusion matching, which is airway closure. So this is what is caused by this cyclic airway closure. Less ventilation than perfusion, also impeding oxygenation. And in the top, you see that we have more ventilation than perfusion. This is what we call high ventilation perfusion. In one sense, it may reflect overdistension, but not necessarily. What is interesting is that this is regularly measured with the monitoring equipment anesthetists have. And the conclusion is that this is an increase in dead space, but it has nothing to do with dead space. It is a redistribution of ventilation from dependent regions that we have normally to upper regions because we have low VQ, airway closure, and we have atelectasis. So that explains why we have this change. Now, if we go to intensive care, this is a patient with acute respiratory failure. You see, most of the lung is dense. Let me see if I went to, it jumps by itself, I'm not. The definition of acute respiratory system is it occurs within 1 week after an insult. We have bilateral opacities on chest X-ray. We have shall exclude non-cardiac edema, no fluid overload. I listened to a lady, Dr. Luna, today and realized that we should measure this carefully when defining ARDS. We have different degrees of acute respiratory failure, where Marco Ranieri, another doctor from Italy, has been the leading person to make definitions. And you see that they have hypoxemia. And with severe hypoxemia, you are down to less than 100 millimeter of mercury. The global incidence is a little difficult, but perhaps 50, 60 per 100,000 patients. If you look at the United States, we have around 200,000 cases a year. And mortality is between 27 and 45% in different papers. And mortality in the US is 75%. It's more than 40%. And that is in a well-developed country. So we face a rather severe situation. Can we do something about this? I'm not quite sure. What we can look at here is we have an overdistension in the top of the lung. We have normally aerated regions, can be a rather limited zone. I don't know why it's jumping. We have then cyclic airway closure in the middle and cyclic alveolar collapse, persistent alveolar collapse, and perhaps also flooding consolidation in the bottom. So we face a number of functional or morphological changes that causes this image. Now the question is one of these regions more important than the other? And we used, positron emission tomography, which I have had available in my department earlier. I'm retired now. So we brought now pigs, not humans, that had developed a double hit Wheelie model, that is. They were exposed to lung lavage to eliminate surfactant, and induced ventilation with a large tidal volume and low PEEP. And this together caused lung damage, and you can see that the use of the fluorodeoxyglucose reflects inflammation. It's not a very specific marker, but anyway, we used FDG or fluorodeoxyglucose. And you can see that the highest activity of this fluorodeoxyglucose is in the middle of the lung, not in the bottom, not in the top. And you have a healthy lung here where you see almost the same activity in the bottom, in the sick and the healthy control, and not much difference in the top either. We have the problem here. This is interesting. We have assumed earlier that atelectasis is a cause of inflammation that make it difficult to bring the patient away from the ventilated support and can die. It's a contributor to the high mortality. Or can it be overdistension in the upper part? No, not the collapse, not the overdistension. If we compare this with the previous figure, you see that it occurred where we have cyclic airway closure and cyclic alveolar collapse, if that also occurs. So this is the major problem. This computer has its own brain, I'm sorry. So how to then to ventilate? Standard today is to provide a small tidal volume, perhaps this amount, 4 to 8 mL per kilogram body weight. If you compare that with your own spontaneous breath, I would say that you breathe around 6-7 milliliters per kilogram body weight as a normal tidal volume. This is standard, so this is what we are aiming at. We would like to have as low inspiratory pressure as possible, less than 30 centimeters of water. But that is not always simple or easy, but that is what you aim at. And you apply a positive end expiratory pressure, which can be from 5 to 30 centimeters of water. I would say that 30 is high and can be harmful in itself. And you have your own experience. And today we also talk about the low driving pressure. That is the difference between end inspiratory and end expiratory pressure. Something that is less than 30 minus, for example, 10 will give you 20 centimeters of water pressure, which is a little high. According to the opinion, you will be preferably below 17 centimeters of water airway pressure for the driving pressure. Then you can do recruitment maneuvers. That means that you expand the chest or the lung intermittently, which will then possibly recruit lung tissue. Because if the more the lung is open, the more of the lung that is open, the easier it will be to provide a tidal volume, because it can be go to the most of the lung, and then the inspiratory pressure will be lower. If you have a lot of atelectasis and airway closure, most of the ventilation will go to the upper part, and that can also require higher pressure to enable the tidal volume. So the recruitment marrow can be an important part of the treatment. The question is still how it should look like. Prone position has become popular. The reason is that in the severe ARDS, survival seems to be better with the prone position. And why is that? In the prone position, the lungs are less exposed to weight from both thoracic organs and the pressure from the abdomen via the diaphragm. So it may keep lung volume a little higher. Then you may say that it is also difficult to ventilate the patient in the prone position. In this earlier, there were also problems with eyes and so on. So it is not completely free from risk, but it seems to be beneficial in severely sick patients. Then it can be interesting to see what happens if you have a patient who survives a severe ARDS. This is a patient that we treated in Uppsala, where I'm working. I was not the real doctor of this, but we looked at things. And you can see that this patient, I think it was a lady, 30-year-old, with multiple fractures, lung damage and bilateral. And this first one is the beginning of mechanical ventilation, and you can see how large this collapse of the lung is. And then I think it's around 15 days later, or 13 days later, the patient had recovered to some extent and was breathing spontaneously. But there was a memory effect of the previous situation. The collapsed part was now the aerated part, and the previously ventilated part is now less well ventilated, a lot of densities in it. So the exposure to the large tidal volumes in this area and perhaps high airway pressures caused the damage that showed up later, probably disappearing over time. But you see that we have a persistent, at least for a couple of weeks after the treatment, that shows up in the upper part now. It takes time to recover completely. And you can also see a reminder from the previous animal studies that most of the activity indicating inflammation is in the middle of the lung. To what extent it means anything here can be discussed. But you can see how the lung is affected by the mechanical ventilation. We talk about ventilator-induced lung injury, and that causes a lasting effect after the period of ventilation. The last part of my talk, I will mention alternative techniques very briefly. One that is a la mode today is non-invasive ventilation. To use a face mask or sometimes a helmet to ventilate the patient without intubating the airway. And we have been contacted from Wuhan in China, where they have the center for this new coronavirus infection, and where they have quite a number of casualties. They don't have capacity to intubate and ventilate patients that are coming in continuously. So they have asked, can they do non-invasive ventilation? The problem is that it is a riskful situation when you want to limit spread of the infection. The face mask or the helmet will easily cause a contamination of the air around the patient and then the personnel as well. So it is not an ideal technique when you want to reduce the risk of spreading the inflammation to other patients around, surrounding, also other people around. Another technique is high flow nasal oxygen, HFNO. I guess most of you know it. You provide a lot of oxygen. You can have 60, 70 liters per minute in the nasal bronchus. That then provides a lot of oxygen to the lung. And the high flow will also cause a certain PEEP, positive end expiratory pressure level. So the lung is a little expanded by the HFNO. And in my opinion, you need not have oxygen only. It can be good with a limited oxygen concentration, but the PEEP effect might be valuable and is easy to provide. But again, it is a riskful situation when you have an inflammation that can spread to other people. Cuirass, I will show you a figure on that. That is ventilating with a belt around the chest where you can vary the pressure, inspiration and expiration. And finally, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation or carbon dioxide removal. So if you go to the next one, you see a cuirass. It's a belt that is around the patient, and you can then vary the pressure in the belt so that the cause of ventilation, inspiration, expiration. And it is being limited use of it, but still polio, neuromuscular disease, scoliosis in particular, and there is a certain 5-year survival that might be better than without the treatment. But as you can see, the major indication is impeded ventilatory capacity, not lung dysfunction per se. When mechanical ventilation came, this is a ventilator that I used, or similar to that, they also used the cuirass because there was some memory of what has been done before with the iron iron lung and other things, but that is not what we use today. But cuirass for certain cases. And finally, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation is a last rescue level where you take blood via one catheter through a oxygenator. You oxygenate the blood outside the body of the patient, and then you let the pump flow in the blood into the right heart, mainly right atrium. And this can be a life-saving process. I think the results were better than I thought myself, a lot of numbers, but if you look at this number, it is the survival patient discharged from the hospital, it's 45%. You can discuss the indications and so on, but for me, close to 50% survival was to me a little astonishing. Now I realize, and people admit, that some patients are for sure saved. But other patients may die because of the treatment, the complicated treatment. So I don't see that this may be the real future. I'm not quite sure. There are a lot of efforts. If you want to limit the extracorporeal blood flow, you can just look at carbon dioxide removal. It will require lower flows, and that makes it much easier. So the future may be, perhaps, that you assist in eliminating carbon dioxide with an extracorporeal machine, but ventilate the lungs to provide oxygenation. And this is my last mentioning of this, and I just show you what my wife and do when we are in fresh conditions sailing. This is from Sweden to Gotland or to Finland, I don't remember now. My wife is working hard and I'm sitting at the steering wheel. And with that, I will thank you very much for your attention. Thanks a lot. Yeah, but if you compare with the horse, the human is better off in that respect.
Yes, of course.
I agree that a reason to develop atelectasis is, in fact, poor support by the surrounding tissue. If you have a certain small airway that is closing, will cause atelectasis, but not necessarily, because the surrounding alveoli, if they are still ventilated, they will keep these non-ventilated alveolus open. But if that breaks, because of the frailty, as you say, then atelectasis may develop. But the point is that the normal situation, normal is not the right good word, but the situation is mostly that atelectasis occurs in a certain region and is complete. That is not that we have some regions open, some regions closed. They are all collapsing because they are exposed to the same forces. And that is absorption of oxygen primarily. I would say that to prevent the collapse, it would be good to recruit the lung with intermittent size with a high concentration of nitrogen. It can be, air has around 80% nitrogen, but if you ventilate with, say, 30% oxygen or 40% oxygen, then you have 60-70% nitrogen. If that is given to an open lung, it will not collapse that fast. If you give pure oxygen during the recruitment maneuver, it will collapse within a few minutes. So if you do a recruitment maneuver, then use not pure oxygen, that is to destroy all effects of the recruitment. And a recruitment that is successful in itself would lead to less need of oxygen. So recruitment maneuver should be done with a lower oxygen concentration because the effect will be lasting. And this is a little sidetracked to what you asked for, but it also illustrates the frailty of the lung itself. That's a good question. Not that easy for me to answer for two reasons. One is that I'm not clinically active in this field per se. But the other is that if you reduce the blood flow through the extracorporeal machine to eliminate carbon dioxide, you may reduce the need of ventilation. That is the point. Then you ask, why not add oxygen as well? Then you are able to lower the oxygen concentration. I think that is a very good comment. The question is, can you do that with a reduced blood flow that is suitable for carbon dioxide removal? Because the addition of oxygen to the blood will be small. And I cannot calculate on it right now because this is a question I have not heard before, but it is right, your thinking is correct. I would like to reduce the oxygen concentration in the inspired air because it can cause, as you say, damage by itself, a reactive oxygen species. I have been heavily against the WHO recommendation for hyperoxia during the perioperative period. It has been claimed that you reduce postoperative infection or inflammation, but that is not clearly shown. What we do know is that hyperoxia can cause damage to the lung, not only atelectasis, but also effects as you describe it. And I have written strong editorials against this. I'm happy to hear your question, but you did not get a perfect answer, and I cannot give you. It's a compromise. Can you increase blood flow to some extent? Then you are able to give more oxygen and can reduce oxygen concentration. The alternative is not to have such high oxygen tension in the blood as you think is good. This is erroneous thinking that I think some clinicians are happy, feel comfortable when they have a PaO2 of 300 meter mercury, 200 millimeter mercury, but it has been shown rather cleaner now that mortality goes up with high oxygen concentration. The ideal PaO2 is around 100 millimeter mercury. That is the normal value we have when we are breathing ourselves spontaneously in the healthy lung. I think this is a design by some higher powers. The point is that when lung volume goes down, which it does with the supine position by anesthesia per se, then airways are closing, but not similarly all over the lung. It's a gravitational orientation. We have, and this depends on the pleural pressure at different vertical levels. We have a pleural pressure gradient. During anesthesia, we have a positive pleural pressure in the dependent part of the pleural space. And this causes a pressure that is compressing the airways. But higher up in the lung, in the pleural space, the pleural pressure will still be negative. And there, airways are supported to be stay open. So the reason why we see atelectasis is in the bottom of the lung, in the otherwise healthy patient or healthy lung, is because of this gravitational orientation of the pressures. If you move the patient, and if you do anesthesia in the prone position, I would imagine, we have not done it yet, I would imagine that you will have atelectasis in the new dependent region, that is in the anterior part of the chest. But how much, I do not know. If you rotate the patient, we have done that, rotating a patient that is anesthetized from supine, it has atelectasis in the dorsal part, as we have seen, and you rotate the patient, the lower lung, presuming it is the left lung, it will maintain its atelectasis. The upper lung, the right lung, in this case, will open up. So the vertical level of the lung tissue will affect the atelectasis. And my belief, now I'm speculating a little, why am I rotating during sleep? We know that if you fall asleep, we have taken CT scans in patients during normal sleep. It's a little difficult because the machine wakes them up. But we can take images before they're waking up. And if during the REM phase, rapid eye movement, the lungs are equally prone to collapse as during anesthesia. Now we are breathing air when we sleep, normally. And then, therefore, we don't develop atelectasis. But the decrease in alveolar and airway size is the same during rapid eye movement, REM sleep, as during anesthesia. And this means that if I am not rotating, I will sooner or later develop atelectasis. This is a little apathetic. You can say that you have nightmares or problems with something that keeps you awake and you rotate in the bed. My belief that there is an additional factor, how important, I do not know, and that is that we rotate because the dependent part in one position will then become the non-dependent, and that opens up the airways so that no atelectasis will be caused. We have stretch receptors, so that would be a likely thing to happen. And I have no good answers. I know Alberto Zanella, for example, in Milan, they are studying lungs that are taking from one animal to put them into another. And this is a program to optimize the management of the lung that is taken out. If I were to do this, and with no experience, I have no experience, I would keep the lung open. To be a little cautious. I would have liked to have gotten on and other people around me. But I'm not sure that there is a very strong correlation between the amount of atelectasis and mortality. There are other problems, and you know them better than I do, since I have not been active as you are. But the inflammatory reactions may not be triggered by the atelectasis to the same extent as cyclic opening and closing of airways and of alveoli. I recall by Luciano Gattinoni many years ago that he thought that the best way to prevent the lung from damage is not to ventilate at all. But that is when ECMO was still the hope. But I'm not sure that I would like to do my strongest effort to re-expand collapsed tissue. I know that in Brazil, I know people there, they would do their best. And then they can apply a paper 50 centimeter of water and without clear lung damage. But the problem is that you have circulatory impedance that can be severe. And so there is a limitation, at least as long as you can do it. And they had not better survival, rather less than if you are more cautious with the recruitment maneuver. To me, this means that atelectasis is not the major problem when you have these severely sick patients. I have learned from the chairman, Vincenzo, that we have other mechanisms for inflammatory spread that can be of interest to analyze and to prevent. And my belief is still that mechanical ventilation is a tool to give you more time to do other things. You buy time with the mechanical ventilation to limit and prevent other kinds of damage, not only in the lung, but also in the rest of the body. The mechanical ventilation, I think, will not cause a better survival per se, but giving you time to make things.